mercy and peace to you, God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Most of you know, it's no secret, most of you know that I'm a second career pastor. I didn't go to college to study to be a pastor, straight up. I actually went to college to study to be a high school English teacher. And then later on in life, became a pastor, went to seminary and became a pastor. When I was in college, I went to Western Michigan University in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Go Broncos. And while there, I met somebody from Spain in one of my history classes that we had together. This person that I met in this history class, we became friends, not good friends, but still friends. And we would study together, we'd have conversations about different things. Now, it makes sense, it was from Spain. So you would understand this makes sense. He talked differently, he acted differently, he did things differently from an American Midwest culture, and of course he would. That just makes sense. Of course he would. I don't remember much from the first day of that first history class where I met him, but I do remember this. He was sitting in the seat next to me, and he wrote his name down on a piece of paper. And I didn't know this guy. He showed me his name and he said, "Here, say my name. How do you pronounce this?" That was his introduction. And I looked at it, and I pronounced it exactly how I thought it should be pronounced. I said, "Salvador Vai La Salha," and I even rolled my R to show how sophisticated it was. And that I knew the language pronunciations didn't go the same in all countries. I wanted to show that I knew what I was talking about. I was so off. I was so wrong. He looked back and he said, no, that is not how you pronounce my name. You pronounce my name, Samba by yourself. I said, "What?" He said, "You say Samba by yourself. Go ahead, try it." Okay, alrighty then. Took a deep breath. Samba by yourself. Good, you got it, American. I'm like, I don't even know what I said, but my God. But he was very, very happy that I figured out how to pronounce his name. Stepo Bayesev. Stepo Bayesev had a very hard time at Western Michigan University. In fact, he left after one term to go back to Spain. And I don't know if that was a planned thing, maybe that was a planned thing all along. Maybe it was because he did have such a hard time with the language, the culture, and feeling as though he was fitting in, finding his own place. I don't know. I do know he struggled. I never found out why he went back to Spain. And of course, we lost touch. And that was 20, oh my goodness, that was a long time ago, 26, 27 years ago. But one thing I remember about him, trying to find his own place, trying to figure things out, is that he would say things to me and then ask me, "Did I say that right? Do you understand what I mean?" I said, "Sure." He would also talk to me about people in America, and he would express his confusion at us Americans, why we do the things we do, why we say the things we say, why we talk to each other, treat each other, the interpersonal relationships that we have. And one of the things he would do that always made me laugh on the inside is that when 7x7 would get very frustrated, he would just build up, and then he'd let loose and he would just cuss. And then he'd turn to me and he'd say, "Did I use that word right? Is that what it means?" I would just always answer, "Yeah, yes. Got it." I wasn't going to take the time to teach somebody how to curse in English. For 7x7, Kalamazoo, Michigan and Western Michigan University was a very strange world, and one he never felt at home. Now, our reading from 1 Peter today reminds us of something. As Christians, this world is not our home. The Holy Spirit reminds us you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. C.S. Lewis, Christian author C.S. Lewis, wrote in his book, Mere Christianity, this is what he said, "If I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. Christian musician Cayman's Call sings in one of their songs, I love these lyrics, they sing, "This world has nothing for me, but this world has everything. All that I could ever want, but nothing that I need." It's a reminder to Christians, we don't belong here. This world is not our home. And just like how Stefania Sarah could learn to navigate somewhat his way here, who's never comfortable here, we shouldn't be comfortable here either. Even if we do learn to sort of navigate life. Now before you hear me say what I'm not saying, please let me explain. Because we are chosen, because we're called out from the rest of the world, because we're being built up into something different, that means God's people, you and I, we're not normal. It means we are not, some of them, we are not normal. We don't fit in. We're different than the unbelieving world, but we're different in a good way. Different because we're chosen. We're made new. We're made different. And we are given a title, a royal priesthood. You are royal. I am royal. Now again, please don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying we're better than others. Far from it, we are all sinners destined for hell until grace came in and mercy saved us. We're not better, but we are different. We're chosen, we're set aside. We're part of the royal priesthood of all believers. What does that mean? It means you have been set aside, I have been set aside to be a priest. Right where we are, you and I, I'm the one who's a Christian, is a missionary. And our mission field includes our homes, our families, our workplaces, our schools, the places where we go just to be with other people. It's been given to us by the Savior himself. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ has this. No Christian is immune or can say, well, you know, that's really not for me. If you are a Christian and you have a pulse, it is for you. It is for me. And it is because of who we are. A royal priesthood. A people chosen from the rest of the world to be set aside and used by God that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light in order to reach the lost. But what if they reject me? They're not rejecting you. They're rejecting the Holy Spirit. They're rejecting Jesus. What if I don't know what to say? Well, trust that the Holy Spirit will give you the right words at the right time and work through them. But you don't understand. Again, you don't know me. You see me for an hour a week, maybe around your church, or when we get together in different places. You don't know what's going on in my life. I don't feel holy. I don't feel royal. And I have skeletons in my closet that would make anyone blush. So did Peter. Let's just remember who Peter was. Peter was the disciple that Jesus called Satan. He was the disciple who at first made big boasts, I will never leave your side, Jesus, and then soon, the second the going got tough, he turned tail and ran. He was the apostle who started to succumb to peer pressure in Galatia, and Paul called him out on it in front of everybody. That this is the same person that Jesus also called the rock. Because remember this about Peter too. Let's not forget this about Peter. Peter's name is not Peter. That's not his name. His name is Simon. And when Jesus met Simon, he gave him a new name. He said, Peter, you're not going to be called Simon anymore. You're going to be called Peter, Petros. It means rock. Jesus didn't call Simon his new name based on who he was at that time. Jesus called Simon his new name based on who and what he would become through the power of the Holy Spirit working in him. Jesus called Simon his new name based on what had already been declared would be by God the Father himself. And that same God of Peter's is the same God of ours. The same God who says to you and to me, you are a chosen people,
a royal priesthood, a holy nation,
a people belonging to me. And what are you to do with this? You are to declare my love and my salvation to a world that still sits in darkness, so they can come into the light too. Now, we don't know much about Peter. After the gospel records in the first several opening chapters of the book of Acts, and one reference to him in the book of Galatians, we really don't know much about him. We know he was the leader of the inner 12 disciples. We know he was the leader of the early church of the apostles. We know he was instrumental in teaching and preaching the early church. We know that he actually was the first one to reach out to the Gentiles. Peter was. And we also know that he got into an argument with Paul in public. That much we know about Peter. Other than that, after that, we don't. He just kind of drops off. He is not heard about or heard from again, but he did leave behind two books written through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to remind us that we are aliens and we are strangers in this land. Our real home is in heaven. Our real home built for us since before time began. Our real home we receive not because of anything we've done. We don't deserve it. But we receive through the forgiveness of sins won by Jesus on the cross and the empty tomb. Our real home that will never perish, spoil, or fade. It doesn't matter what others say. It really doesn't. What matters is what God has declared. And God has declared his choosing, his setting aside, and his relationship with his children. We don't have anything to do with all this. The only role we have in this, the only thing we can do is reject it and say, no, thank you. I'm going to try to make it through this world on my own, come up maybe on the other side of life. Good luck with that. In that scenario, what we're left with are the other people the Holy Spirit mentions in this reading, people who stumble over Jesus because of their disobedience, because of their disbelief that leads to disobedience. That history class that I had at Western Michigan University, my first year there, it was very hard. It was a lot harder than any, I think, I was expected. Almost every student in the class struggled with it. It was a lot harder than a 100 level course actually should have been. It was hard. And it was after the first test when everybody in the class pretty much bombed it. That was when set it on. 7 by 7, and I started studying together. We studied before class in the hallway. I commuted at the time. I did not have on campus, so we study on the phone, call each other before the test, and work through things. We needed each other. We needed each other to get through something that was turned out to be a lot harder than we thought it would be. And we talk about this a lot during our adult Bible study on Sunday mornings. We need each other. As brother and sister Christians, we need each other for strengthening the faith, for Christian support on this journey, because let's be honest, sometimes life is a lot harder than we thought it would be. We need each other for the building up of a holy nation. We need each other for the thing that we don't want to need each other for, the thing we don't like. We need each other for accountability. We need each other for reassurance. We need one another. A holy nation is not one person. A holy nation is a group of people together. We stand before God today as his people. Chosen before time began, washed clean by the sacrifice of Jesus, and made perfect in the eyes of our Father. Chosen, royal, holy priesthood of believers. Called out from the dark into his light, and then placed in the dark to be a light for others. It's hard. It's hard. So let's start with prayer. Let's pray. Abba, Father, Behold your children. Behold those whom you created, you called, you set aside, and you made different. Behold those you lived in the flesh for, died for, rose for, and promised to come back for. Behold those you continue to call out in order to forgive sin, strengthen faith, and sustain us for the journey that we're on. Behold your children. Forgive us for forgetting that we are your children. And because of that, we are supposed to be different from the rest of the unbelieving world in what we say and do. Forgive us for forgetting the holy, royal position and place this in. Forgive us for letting our light dim and sometimes go out completely in the places you placed us. Holy Spirit, touch us, each and every one, with your power. Remind us who and whose we are and why. And help us to be your light in the places where you have put us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.